Hi, and welcome back to Mingus on Tech. I'm Ken Mingus, Executive Editor at Computer World. I'm here with Lucas Mirian, our senior writer. We're going to be talking about blockchain and how it's going to revolutionize maybe everything. Stick around. All right, welcome back. So, Lucas, you've been writing a lot about blockchain this year, and it's getting a lot of attention, especially even in the last week or so, as lots of cryptocurrency, there seems to be a rush to it, and everybody's saying, okay, what is cryptocurrency? How did it get started? And blockchain sort of underpins, that's how blockchain really got its start, right?
Right. It's a peer-to-peer network technology. It's a write once, append many database, for lack of a better word, that is open and distributed and is unlimited in the way it can grow.
Okay. That's what I wanted to try to figure out, is to maybe give people an idea, because I think I was actually speaking at a class over at BU yesterday, and one of the students there asked me about cryptocurrencies and blockchain. So it's obviously getting a lot of buzz. All right. So blockchain is the definition is distributed ledger technology.
Yep.
That basically can be used by a variety of industries, but seems to have been taken up first in fintech, financial services, right?
Right. And in particular, other than cryptocurrencies, which we're hearing a lot about, like Bitcoin, like Ether from Ethereum, it's good for cross-border transactions, because there's a gray area where regulators can't touch it, and you can have users from across multiple nations, across multiple borders, that can use this network in order to exchange currency. And a lot of banks are coming together to create blockchains for just that purpose, especially for small money transfers.
Yeah, like mobile payments, right?
Right, mobile payments would be a good use.
Because I think one of the stories you wrote about was this effort to sort of put together a blockchain system for mobile payments. I think it was in the in the Pacific.
Yeah, it was South Pacific, because most of the payments are under $100. They do it at, like, the small convenience stores, check cashing places, that sort of thing. There would have been a lot of fees associated with that, and this bank was able to work with IBM to use their cloud service to construct a blockchain in order to create this electronic transfer network.
Yeah, and it's also, too, interesting, another one of the stories that you've written involves Maersk, I think, the shipping company, that has found a way to sort of take blockchain and integrate it with its supply chain, right?
Not supply, but shipping. Cargo,
shipping.
Yeah,
shipping.
So tracking shipments across, because you have one container ship going to multiple countries. And believe it or not, like sort of the healthcare industry, which is still stuck on the fax machine in many cases, it was very much paper-based.
Yeah.
So you would literally have a piece of paper at each port, and you'd have to sign off multiple signatures for the cargo, you know, inspections, taxes, checking, you know, to ensure the shipment's correct. It was a lengthy process. It was costly. This is an open ledger that everyone can share at the same time, so that you know exactly when a shipment has arrived, that it's been inspected, that it's been delivered, and all the parties involved know it.
Isn't that one of the points about blockchain, is that what makes it so unique is that everybody on the blockchain can see in pretty much real time what's going on, whether it's a financial transaction, whether it's shipping around the world, there's also some talk around healthcare about being able to do this with, like, patient records? Or?
Yeah, they're still testing this out. One of the problems, so it's a plus and a curse.
Yeah.
So it's open, but it's also open so that everybody can see the information in it. So it's great that it's open, you can see all the information, but at the same time, you can see all the information. So if it's healthcare records, everybody on that blockchain can see everybody else's healthcare information.
Right.
There are a number of groups that are working on, you know, ways to kind of create sub networks so that you can define who can see a particular record, but that's not something that's available right now.
Okay, so this is a situation where there may be interest in the healthcare industry, but the transparency that is considered a blockchain plus might not be a plus.
Yeah, right now it's actually a deterrent to using it, but they are working on methods to restrict who can see what. Much in the same way. So there are open blockchains, public blockchains, and there are private or permissioned blockchains. So for instance, if you were exchanging healthcare records, you wouldn't be doing this on a Bitcoin-like
right.
open
So everybody ledger. Can see your records.
So everybody in the world can
no,
see
No, we don't
their
want
records.
That. I can see why that would not be good.
So they aren't. One of the pluses of blockchain is that it doesn't need to be centrally administered, but it can be. So you can have a permissioned blockchain or a private blockchain between within a hospital group yep. or between companies or within a company's four walls just for certain particular users that have to attain a permission to use it.
Is there any limit to the size that a blockchain can be? Can
there, it get? There isn't. And it doesn't use that much compute power. It was a question. We did a webinar last week, and one of the questions was, you know, there's a concern that it could grow too large and that it would eat up too much CPU. Mm-hmm. Capacity, and that's just not the case. It eats a very tiny amount of CPU capacity, and it's distributed across many, many nodes. Each one of those nodes timestamps an entry, which is part of the wonderful thing about it.
Well, I was going to say, that's one of the things that's considered so important about blockchain is that, you wrote about it last week about this underpinning a new trust economy
right.
because it's transparent, verifiable, timestamped, and it can't be modified, right?
No.
Once a chain is added to the blockchain, it's there for everybody to see, inspect, and do whatever.
Once a new set of transactions is entered and approved, it's automatically linked to the previous set of transactions. That block, and that's why it's called a blockchain. It's linked to the previous set of transactions.
Yep.
Cannot be changed. It's immutable, and each one contains its own hash.
Okay, so that way you can, one of the things you've written about is the possibility for smart contracts.
Yeah.
Or even something like, I can see this in real estate, where you might have multiple parties in different places, somebody's buying a house or buying property, and you need to track this transaction through the lawyers, through the financial people, through the buyers and the sellers.
Right.
And is that one of the ways this is being envisioned as being used?
Now, it is being used. Wrote here, ShelterZoom, and this new company has just created a blockchain for buying and selling real estate online. So, it's a settlement and clearance type system where you can put property in the blockchain for sale and the deal can be completed between all the parties in that blockchain.
Okay, and they can all see the process as it goes from start to finish. Okay. Yeah. One of the things, at least early on, there was a lot of talk that blockchain, because of the nature and the way it's built and the fact that everybody has visibility into each link, if you will, that it would be sort of inherently secure.
Mm-hmm.
I know that, there are some issues because, first of all, there's no real oversight in how these things are being built. It's sort of like a Wild West, right?
Yeah, right now it is. It's very much a Wild West. It's the architecture of the blockchain itself is innately secure.
Okay.
However, there is software, application-specific software, used on top of it in order to create it for a specific market like real estate or cross-border transactions, and that software can have security holes. And in fact, you've had instances where entire cryptocurrency chains have been hacked and that the money has been frozen. I mean, millions of dollars in cryptocurrency has been frozen out. So as soon as for example, if you lose your hash algorithm, you can no longer access the funds tied to that cryptocurrency.
How do you get it back? Do you know?
Right now, there really isn't a system getting it back.
Okay, so you don't want to.
You're locked out.
Okay, so you're locked out, and if it involves a lot of money, then you might be out that money?
Yeah, you could very well be out that money. I think that there may be ways, I've not read about them, but there may be ways of verifying who you are and then, giving that. But you can't really be given a new hash. That's the thing. It's tied to that specific hash algorithm.
Okay, so even though it has a lot of promise in a variety of industries and is itself secure, the software that runs on top of it or would be used with it may not be secure.
Right.
And there are concerns. This is a similar, if you've got a password on your computer that you absolutely have to get into it and you lose the password, you may have problems.
It's a good analogy. That's exactly the problem.
Yeah. Okay. And any thoughts on where it goes from here? I mean, it just seems to be popping up in a variety of places, but I can't quite tell what the direction is in terms of where blockchain will be in, a couple of years maybe.
virtually every expert that I've talked to has compared blockchain to the importance of the internet itself to open software, so Linux, and the same kind of development path. So back in the 1990s, Linux had a lot of promise.
Yeah.
But people didn't really see how big it could eventually be. In the same way, blockchain may take years to meet its potential. It could take decades at this point. Right now, there's a lot of fervor around it. One investment expert that I talked to said he's all in on Bitcoin. He just believes this is going to continue to grow. But there's also a lot of wariness about it. When something's over $17,000 for a single Bitcoin and continues to grow in leaps and bounds, it feels like a bubble.
Yeah, that to me, when you talk about it, I mean, obviously one of the reasons I wanted to ask you about blockchain is because of what's going on with cryptocurrency right now. And there does seem to be this sort of mad dash gold rush into Bitcoin at the moment, with not a lot of people, I think, understanding, where their money is going, how it might be tied up, and what they might lose.
Right.
That's Bitcoin or cryptocurrency more so than blockchain. Blockchain is what enables that whole system to work.
Exactly.
But it is interesting that there are experts who see it as disruptive as the internet, depending on how on who develops blockchains, whether these blockchains can be shared or sold. I know IBM has been working on trying to develop some. All right, so big technology, lots of uses, a lot of people experimenting with it across a variety of industries, and potentially disruptive, but too soon to say exactly how.
Yeah, I think what I like about blockchain when I first started investigating it is the interest in it is very much organic. Yeah. And what I mean by that is when I talked to vendors and their customers, what I was hearing is the vendors would say, our customers are pinging us about this. They want to know how they can use it. What is it? How can we use it?
Yeah.
And so these vendors, even folks like EMC, who I didn't know. I talked to an executive. I said, what the heck are you doing with blockchain? They said, well, everybody keeps asking us, tell me what this is and how I can use it. And how can it reduce my administrative overhead? And so they've gotten involved in it as well for that purpose. The same thing goes with IBM and other the large vendors out there. They're trying to help their customers understand this and actually create a cloud where they can dip their toes in blockchain without taking the risk of developing their own blockchain infrastructures.
Okay, so it's going to be disruptive, maybe. It's definitely being experimented with in a variety of places, and so I'm sure we'll be hearing more about it over the next couple
of years.
We'll have to revisit in 6 months or a year and see where we are.
Yeah.
Great. Lucas, thanks a lot for the info on blockchain. For now, on blockchain at least, that's a wrap.